very meaningful panel, and I'll give you two reasons why it is. First, my key sponsors are on this panel. That just goes without saying. And second, these people collectively handle about, I would say, 40 to 50% of the wealth right now. Can we say that clearly? IDBI and CGTMSE put together. Significant portion in the MSE space, absolutely. So we have to take this panel and the panelists extremely seriously. A lot of discussion happened about funding, the mechanics of funding, what do VCs like, what they don't like, what really is the burn rate, how can you grow your company. But amidst all this conversation, we actually missed on a very important aspect or the very important source of funding, which is perhaps for which there's so much information asymmetry available. People don't know much about it. And the very reason we have this panel is to tell people that you can't ignore the good old debt. And I'll give you three reasons for that. First, if you are a startup in the initial stages of building out, do you even have the wherewithal and the knowledge on your conversation with the VC? Do you really have a business plan which is fortified enough to actually satisfy their future projections? Are you really prepared enough to have those unpleasant conversations with the VC? Why not take a route where you don't have to even fork out so much equity, but also gives you comfort at the back of your mind whilst you are scaling up and whilst you are preparing yourself to become VC ready? I think the reason why most of the startups fail, and one of the key reasons for that is also that a lot of startups raise funding a little too early on and raise too much, because what also happens is that if you raise too much capital, you don't really know what to do with it. So there's a capital foie gras culture that also happens. So I also want to understand from this August panel about venture debt versus venture equity. Now, equity as an asset class, as a financial asset class, is a riskier asset, right? It's called venture capital for a reason. It's the highest form of risk capital that is available on the table right now. It comes from a private pool of investors who, in the initial stages of your startup, are putting their own money, which could be salaried wealth or whatever. And as you grow, you go for a Series A, Series B, which, by the way, is somebody else's money that they're investing. Then you have venture debt as an option. Now, what is venture debt? And I would like to have you sort of talk a little about venture debt. That why do you think entrepreneurs are going for venture debt as a funding option increasingly?
Right. Thank you. See, I have spent 24 years in venture capital, private equity. And I can always talk why equity is better. Having said that, last year we created Valuable. And the first fund is a venture debt fund. And for the first time, I have spent time, understanding this product. The fact is, an entrepreneur, when he requires money, he will take money from wherever it is coming. Ideally, if it is coming through a venture capitalist, a private equity guy, that's an easy option, because particularly when you are in a burn stage, you don't have to worry about servicing and thinking about that, have to pay it back. Obviously, it comes at a cost of dilution. At the same time, if at that stage a lender were to come in, whether the lender will be comfortable when you are burning money and you don't have a visibility, how will you be paying it back? So sometimes it is not a choice of whether you want to take equity or debt. As I said, ideally it would be equity. In a stable company, when you're in a growth stage and you are very conscious of dilution, that's when you will be looking at venture debt more as a, I would say, bridge option. In the sense that, you have raised a Series A, you have brought your business to a particular level, you know in the next 6 months, 12 months, you will be going in for your next round. And you are not desperate to raise that round at a low valuation. You know that by scaling up your business, you can get much better valuation. Also, you know, by that time, possibly you will be able to scale it up within the options of reaching out to more VCs and be, you know, developed. From that perspective, venture debt is an extremely crucial means of finance which has come up. As a matter of fact, while the VC guys, they kind of have a natural resistance toward venture debt, their portfolio company taking venture debt, because all said and done, the lender has a preferred right to receive the cash flows over anything which is available either for the VCs or for the growth. From that perspective, it is not something that they wholeheartedly support, but from an entrepreneur perspective, since it saves dilution, it is actually very, very good. I think as an initial thing, I have taken too much time.
Thanks for that. I want to come to you now, sir, Mr. Varma. In terms of a budding entrepreneur who is just starting out, let's do their capital structure allocation. I have an idea. I don't know if it will work or not. I'm still in that stage of building a prototype. Do you think it's really even, I would say, rational for me to approach an angel fund and give out my 25% in one go? And why not take care of the government scheme, which is actually giving me, say, those 20 lakhs without a collateral guarantee? Of course, the final say is with a bank. Why are startups or entrepreneurs not going through this route? Why do you think there is the mismatch? Is it information asymmetry? Is it just the knowledge base is not there? What really is lacking if there's such a good scheme available?
The basic thing would be information asymmetry is one thing. But at the same time, I would also say that, the bankers, when they decide to lend, they need something tangible on table. So that is a big hindrance. At least traditionally, this has been the story so far. So, a person comes up with an idea and a green, first-time enterprise, he is coming. The bankers would be a bit wary, despite CGTMSE being there, because CGTMSE comes into the picture only when you decide for a loan. So I always keep telling the bankers, the motto should be guarantee because the loan is there. It shouldn't be the other way around, because you give a loan only because guarantee is there. That would be, a very bad narration a misuse of the government scheme also. So first the banker has to get themselves satisfied about the project. And dare I say that till date that the kind of credit financing that has been happening by the bank, as I said in my earlier this thing, it has been like in the banking jargon, we have been told the SIDBI has come out from IDBI. So a lot of common culture is there. So we are always told that look at the past papers and decide on present, and so that becomes a challenge. In these type of cases, there is nothing to look back. So that becomes a limiting factor. So the bankers would be a bit wary. But now, once the things have started linking with the cash flows and looking at the future more effectively than the past, so perhaps the change is happening. So apart from these two things, there are other things also which the government is doing. That seed capital funding is there. The DPIT has come out with a 2000 crore worth of seed capital fund. So that can be utilized. SIDBI also is doing something in terms of incubation support, where they are giving funding to the incubators, and the part of money which is required that goes from the incubator, which is given by the SIDBI. So a lot of other things, apart from the a typical venture debt which Ajay is doing, and a typical lending with IDBI is doing, and something apart from what I am doing, there are other methods also. But one thing is for sure, that I keep telling the borrowers, even in my avatar as a bank when I was in SIDBI, that please take loan and try to grow. I have seen many people who used to come to me, unko main bolta tha ki boss aap loan lijiye badhaiye. The bigger things used to be at that time, of course, this much data integration was not there. So, chota sa balance sheet hai, and they would come. So, unka balance sheet ya unka PNL dikhega 1.5 crore something, and they will say, I want to buy a machine of 1 crore. So, boss, ye to hoga nahi. Bola, nahi, 1.5 crore to dikha rahe hain, sir. So, actually, again, there is an old story that every entrepreneur used to have 3 balance sheet, one for the tax authorities, one for the CA, and one for the wife. So these things used to be there. So, I mean, I always, one Sardarji was there and he's indebted to me even till date. I told him, boss, it doesn't make sense. I mean, if you want your son also to keep operating at the level at which you are operating, then it's fine. But otherwise, you must start showing what you are doing, make your balance sheet robust, because at that time it was balance sheet financing, and then take loan. So mind it, I mean, credit also is not that bad an idea, because if you see the inflation and also the real rate, it is, I mean, common thing which we are taught in economics that when the high inflation is there, the borrowers are always benefited rather than the lender. So, I mean, keep that in mind, and I always tell them that various options are there, but I don't believe that being bootstrapped and, you know, limiting your ambition. So please go either to him or to him. In between, come to me also, but please do that and grow big. Think big and grow big. I mean, don't limit your aspiration by being bootstrapped.
Thanks for that, sir. There's people who are like clapping. They felt so inspired by what you said. I want to come to you now, Mr. Suresh, from an IDBI Bank perspective. This, what Mr. Varma just said, that there is an innate kind of hindrance to investing or to borrowing into startups. What qualifies if I'm a startup, so for instance, Fez is here, he's selling some products online. Suppose his top line revenue is say 50 lakhs or 1 crore. Would you be open to lending to someone like that if it's a loss-making company? I just want to ask you like some questions right up there, because that will be the story of many of startups and MSEs out there in this room. So I'm just giving you and like hitting the bullseye with a straight up question.
Yeah, good afternoon everyone. The question is very straight. Okay, so will you give the loan to the startups? Yeah. Correct. Yes, of course. This is my straightforward answer. See, the how, the only the difference is, see, you are into the business, we are also into the business. See, banking, everybody knows you are doing your business. We are into the lending, like taking a deposit and giving the loans. If you are not giving the loans, we will be at loss. So we have to pay the deposit as the interest. Oh, okay. Now the question is, sir, then why there is a reservation? Right. So when, if you are an established player is coming and with a balance sheet and immediately you are ready to go, or you are going behind the corporates and you are giving at very, very throwaway prices, for a budding entrepreneurs, what is the difference? Now you see the only one thing, from the MSME perspective we will talk. Okay, see, now if you go by the startups, again, it is like a very big corporate. So now you must be knowing many startups are the unicorns. India is the hub of the unicorns, right? So now let us restrict our discussion only to the tune of MSMEs. Okay. See, basically bankers will be looking at to you your commitment. Now for you, one project is the new. For a banking perspective, it is not a new. So there Ajay must have experienced the n number of projects in the same location are in the same geography. Okay. So they will have a fair idea. Okay. So whether it will go through or not. And everybody must have started at a zero only at one point of time. Okay. So they will be looking for what is your commitment. Now, promoter is there. He is having an experience in some other activity and he is having a zeal to do this activity. Absolutely, we will take it forward. And sir, my loan amount is small. Yes, government of India has a lot of schemes are there, especially for the startups. And the startups up to 5 crore, we can fund. Now the question is, sir, straight away 5 crore is there, then I will go for a bigger loans. Now here only there is some disconnect is there. You gradually scale up yourself. So commitment, gradual scaling up. And today's world, technology is so advanced. Okay. Say for example, now only we need 3 things. To give a loan or not, we should see your past track record, right? Today, by looking at, now just by inputting your name, I can figure it out either, is there any traffic violation case against you or not, I can find it. Okay, I need your name and a DL, right? Now, if I'm inputting your PAN and GST, entire data within a fraction of seconds, I can take it. So, unlike in the previous era where we have started our career, it is not like that. So, today everything is in a technology driven. Immediately we can figure it out what is happening in the
field and what you are doing, right? So commitment, scaling up gradually, bringing your contribution little higher. See, generally banking will be looking for 25%, 30% is the margin. So your commitment, sir, I am ready to invest more than that. This is seen as a very big positive factors. Now third thing, viable or not? As I said earlier, yes, you are having a certain plan. We will validate in that plan. If it is found okay, definitely we will take it forward. Third things are collateral. Of course, CGTMSE support is there. Now it has been enhanced to 5 crore, right? And earlier it was used to be for the only for the limit. If you are availing for the term loan, if you are taking any machinery purchase or anything, it is used to be for the original sanction limit. Now it is not like that. It is only based on the your outstanding. So term loan gradually it will come down. So security support is there from the government. Fourth thing, you keep your accounts in a very, very transparent way. Right? GST, it is a one-to-one. Right? When you are filing a GST, immediately I can find out what is your HSN code, who is from where you are buying, invoice to invoice, today we will be tracking. So you are buying it from X party, selling into Y party. When you are making the buying, what is the quantity you are making and to whom, how much quantity you are selling. Then you have to make the payment upon. So today all the softwares will be reading these three data. Okay. Purchase data, sale data, and the bank software, bank statement. So you have to make the payment to purchase and get the payment for the receipt. So now there is no need for human intervention. They will understand what is your margin because it will be validated with your ITR, right? So immediately they will tell you, boss, your business is growing. You can keep on avail the loan. So once this thing is there, there is no hurdle for availing any loan for any MSME.
It's very, very refreshing to hear, like from a very conventional bank perspective, you gave a straight answer. Yes, we're ready to fund to startups. So I think it's incredible. Like really, I think from a very serious perspective, if this country has an ambition to really become a startup nation, these are very conducive steps being taken in the right direction, right? I mean, CGTMSE, we have a bank like IDBI Bank saying that I will come forward and sort of really, really partake into plans of MSMEs. You have venture debt funds, and then you have someone like GetVantage. Now that's a pretty interesting player because I think I see you as a quasi between a VC and a bank. How would you sort of identify yourself?
First introduction about GetVantage. My name is Atul. I am the CFO for GetVantage. We are an embedded financing and growth capital platform for MSMEs and startups in India. While sir in his last session was talking about how banks and the banking system is moving from an asset-backed lending to a cash flow-based lending, we pioneered that 4 years back when we started in 2020. We started right amidst COVID, and with the first wave of COVID that we started funding, doing cash flow-based financing for D2C companies and e-commerce sellers because they were the first ones to start doing it. But today we have expanded that segment to close to 25 sectors now, and more than 20,000 businesses have applied on the platform. We have disbursed more than 1,200 crores in the last 4 years, and committed to deliver more than 2,000 crores in the next 18 months. And we don't believe in equity, taking a portion of your business or taking collateral. We believe in the cash flow of the business, a small business, a new age business. We believe in the cash flow of the business, and basis those future revenues, we underwrite, and we have developed our own underwriting models to do that. Today, across 25 sectors, we work with D2C companies, B2B SaaS services companies, clean tech, EV, all these kind of sectors that we fund today. Incidentally, more than 45% of our portfolio businesses are women and first-time entrepreneurs. So the big thumbs up on the new to credit, as well as we don't depend on your previous credit history also. It's about the cash flow of the business that we depend on, and basis that we fund the business. We always say to our business that you require all forms of capital. You require an equity, whether you are starting a business, you're taking an angel money, or you're taking money from your family and friends and starting the business. At certain point of time, you take a venture debt. At certain point of your time in your business cycle, you become eligible for a bank line, but you always have to take all forms of capital. No capital can substitute the other capital because every capital has a specific use and specific need. You can't fund a asset with a short-term money. You can't dilute equity for your working capital requirements. So for every specific need, there's a capital, and every capital complements each other. In our journey also, we have funded bootstrap businesses, companies who are at 3 months of revenues or 6 months of revenues as well, to companies at Series D as well. And at various scale, we have seen that we have funded new to credit companies. They are companies with bank lines. They are companies with lines from NBFC, private sector, but they have a cash flow based financing solution from GetVantage as well, because there was a specific use for that business at that point of time.
I want to come to you, Mr. Varma, and sort of you, sort of what you were talking about. And it's fascinating that we also had Rahul Gupta of Valuable on our podcast some time back. And he said this in a sort of a very, very interesting revelation that, Shrija, entrepreneurs don't give the importance to venture debt investors as much they give to VCs. For instance, the founder himself or herself doesn't even come for these meetings. They give a very sort of first cousin kind of treatment to venture debt. Why is that? Why is founders not treating debt as a founder's first capital the way VCs brag themselves to be, that we are founders first?
If I may take first. So it is actually very clear that the debt takes care of the financing need of the company, wherein equity sets the valuation benchmark. You know, you have a negotiation. What is that you negotiate with a lender? You will negotiate the duration, the coupon rate, the collateral. That's all. Wherein with the equity guy, you have to sell the story. You have to sell the dream. You have to excite him with the, why this is a differentiated business model and why it will grow faster than the industry. For that is storytelling. Actually, if you ask me, I've spent close to a quarter of a century with entrepreneurs, and one of the best things that I like about this business is that I end up meeting some of the brightest brains, and they come and they tell the story from how, from a very small base, they started the business and where they have brought it to. Now, that storytelling is required for equity. That storytelling is not required for debt. And that's the reason debt-related decision. I'm talking debt in general. I'm not necessarily talking about venture debt. I'm talking about negotiating with the bank. That primarily, falls onto the CFO to negotiate. And I think that has been the conventional practice. Having said that, in the last 5-7 years, I mean, the venture debt in India has been more like a 10-year kind of a product. But in last 5-7 years, the entrepreneurs have started understanding the value of venture debt, because they know while the VCs, the existing VCs, would not want the company to be loaded with debt, he has to do it because he has to protect his equity, his estate. Because by the time there is the Series A and Series B, effectively the entrepreneurs typically comes below majority. And if they know that for their growth, they may have to go to C, D, E, all these rounds. And if they keep on diluting their equity for their funding needs, it may not be the most appropriate thing for them. So from that perspective, there is a change. But I'll just explain why there is a difference.
Now, just to add some other perspective to what Ajay has just said, I mean, your question that why a debt is never given the kind of importance that equity is given. See, it is basically in our genes, our DNA, the Indian culture. I mean, I think apart from the Charvak Darshan, we said that Yavat Jivet, Sukham Jivet, Rinam Kirtva, Kritam Pivet. Iske alawa, koi bhi darshan aisa nahi hai jisme rin lene ko ek achhi baat batai gayi ho. So that is one thing we have been told right from our childhood, that whatever, I mean, this is what I was referring to, being bootstrapped and all. People have been told ki paisa mat lo yaar. Ek to wo concept hai. Dusra ye hai ki once you are into the debt kind of a thing, there is always the concept, psychological concept of a giver and a taker. The person who is giving the loan, namely the bankers that are we consider ourselves as the, the somebody who is giving. Hamesha ye, hamare darshan mein ye gaya hua hai, dene wale ka haath hamesha lene wale se upar rehta hai. I mean, all those things are there. So all, I mean, what he is telling is absolutely correct. These things are changing because something which has run for generations, may not entirely be true in today's context. So it is changing, but I guess these are the issues which are there back in the mind in both players, the one who is going to get a debt and the one who is deciding to give a loan. I mean, the scenario of those era is not lost in our minds when the banker would sit and, you know, kind of dictate terms. I mean, Suresh, he was just telling that it is the creditor. I mean, the person whom I give the loan, because he is giving me the money rather than the depositor. But you just recollect. I'm blessed with a loud voice. So you just recollect how actually it used to happen. A person with a 5 crore deposit walks into the banker. The bank manager will go receive in a term. A person who comes with a request of 5 crore. So he'll be told to sit and wait. So this is a culture. But I am with Ajay when he says that the things are changing, and now the debt, particularly the venture debt, is being taken very, very seriously, and everybody is realized that each kind of Mr. Suresh was telling, each kind of finance, let's not call it a debt or credit, has its own importance, and now people are deciding based on their own requirement.
Thanks for that. And I think we should just take it sort of from what the finance minister just said in her budget in terms of the doubling down of the importance on the MSME space. And she really, really mentioned CGTMSE also in terms of the work that they're doing, the economic survey, and the fact that now there are new Mudra loan scheme in the MSME space. But sir, I want to understand sort of from both of you that Mr. Varma has said since morning also that it's collateral free guarantee, which is a big boon for startups. But then why do we hear from banks that banks will not lend without a collateral? Why is there a mismatch? How comfortable are you receiving a note from CGTMSE guaranteeing a startup? What do you look for? Because the final decision is still yours to lend to the borrower or not. So despite the CGTMSE note also, what is it that gives you discomfort?
See, Sarah's rightly pointed out, traditionally, there is nothing to blame or anything. Traditionally, banker is a collateral based lending, especially when it comes to the MSMEs. So now fintech companies are coming and they are looking into the cash flow. So banks, they will be seeing both. Okay. So it is not only collateral. They will be looking the cash flow, but for comfort's sake, comfort for whom? Not for the customer. Okay. Only for this is getting changed now. Okay. So this was our thought process in the earlier days. Okay. Fortunately or unfortunately, it is everyone to be blamed. So because again, it is based on experience. When loan is secured with security, the behavior from the customer is different. When it is unsecured, it is a behavior is from the different. Okay, now customer will be thinking, say example, I will tell you, textile, so garment segments. So you people must be seeing in the newspaper, it is a highly labor intensive sector, right? Now, due to the competition from the other countries, so this segment is dying like anything, right? Now, this is a nothing fault of the entrepreneur and their intent is very clear. Right? But due to the global perspective, they are taking a hit. Slightly, I am deviating the topic, coming to the straight. So collateral, as I said, so that era is changed now. Okay. So because the era is changed, say 2 years back or 5 years back, I may not know whatever you are telling, I have to believe. So now that today, it is not like that. Right? As I said earlier, again, I am repeating, with a fraction of second, we can take everything, right? And everybody is into the cash flow only. Earlier also, bankers are into cash flow only. So now also, cash flow. Now when the support is coming from the other areas, say for example, Mudra loan, they have yesterday budget, it was enhanced to 20 lakhs. And the CGTMSE in the last year budget, it was enhanced to 5 crore. So whenever these supports are coming, definitely banks will be. See, now if you ask the CGTMSE, now you see the percentage of the loans. So in, say for example, 15 years back, hardly it is a 1% or 2%. Today in Delhi, we are having a 26% our out of my portfolio, 26% is under CGTMSE. Okay. So this itself will show you the difference, how we are moving.
If I can add my 2 cents to it. The frankly speaking, the most important aspect why the banker would be, it's the concept of the skin in the game. I mean, that he hinted at that they always feel comfortable when the borrower's thing is there. Otherwise, I mean, again, traditionally it is fed in our minds that something, some guarantee is there from the government side and all, then the borrowers would go berserk and they would not be so serious and all. I mean, I'm just sharing with you that the bankers, they let their borrowers know that their loans are covered by CGTMSE. The many of the NBFCs, they do not even let their borrowers know for the fear that if they come to know that it's covered under CGTMSE, their behavior might change. So that is the concept that we are working at, the how the government schemes work. Everybody feels that it's a free, this thing. So that is a fear. And the point number two that I want to just quickly say, that ultimately what a security or what a guarantee does, it does not affect the PD of a loan. It does not affect the probability of default. What it does, it minimizes the LGD, the loss given default, that is minimized. So if an account has to go bad, it would go bad irrespective of the fact whether it is covered by a collateral or covered by a guarantee. So now the banker has to look at it, that in which case the LGD would be the minimum. So obviously there only I pitch my thing, that LGD would definitely be lower when it is covered by a guarantee, because one, the coverage is much higher than what a collateral can offer. Collateral will never be able to offer 75% of the loan, and with the haircuts and all, here 75% straight away you will get. And there, that is where the guarantee actually scores. So this realization, as he also is telling, from 1%, 2%, 26%, so gradually it is coming. So these are all good indications that we are moving in the right direction.
So just to sort of clarify the guarantee in very simple terms, in English or Hindi, if I have taken the loan and it's backed by CGTMSE of say up to 20 lakhs, but I'm not able to repay as a startup, so what happens? The government pays to the bank, or what happens?
No, it is simple. Like once the account becomes NPA, as I said, that the account can turn into NPA irrespective of the fact whether it is covered by collateral and this thing, that is PD. Once it is done, then the bankers lost their claim to me and I settle the claim. So ultimately I pay back. If in your example 20 lakh rupees ka loan diya hai, so in that the coverage in our new scheme it is 80%. So out of 20 lakh loan, 16 lakh would be made good by us. So the banker's risk is reduced. Unka 20 lakh ka loss ho raha tha, now they are having a loss only of 4 lakh because 16 lakh is coming. Now replace me with a collateral. No collateral would be there to the extent of 80%. I mean, nobody would be able to give. So there lies the beauty of this guarantee scheme.
And there lies the beauty of the partnership. Like Mr. Suresh said, that 25% is now done with CGTMSE. Now, last question, I want to sort of get you in. This, like somebody also asked, this entire difference between startups and MSME. I think the underlying lens really is technology. As long as you are manufacturing, as long as there's a unit, you are qualified as MSME. The minute the technology quotient is there, you're qualified as quote unquote startup. Because when you become a tech company, perhaps the predictable revenue stream is not there. The predictability of revenue stream is not there. If you are somebody who's doing cash flow kind of financing, how much of your portfolio is tech? How much of it is non-tech? And why tech? Is tech a deterrent for banks? I want to understand. Yeah.
So I would put it like this, all businesses for us, whether it's MSME or startup, these are small businesses, right? We talked about venture debt and VC. I think not more than 2% of the entire, so we have 64 million MSMEs in the country today. How much of that is credit served? It's hardly 8% or 9%. 55 million MSMEs don't get credit at all. Small businesses as well. Less than 2% of the VC money flows to the businesses, right? And venture debt follows the VC money. So what happens to the remaining 98% of the business? That is where players like us with our own regulated entity, NBFC, also comes in, where we co-lend and co-invest with the bank partners and NBFC partners to do cash flow based financing solutions for these guys. In our portfolio today, if you talk about 40 to 50% businesses are bootstrapped. They would never raise equity money because they are here to build a sustainable business model and they believe in, like the last segment we talked about, they want to look at the bottom line. Those are the businesses that they're taking capital. There are obviously loss making companies also, cash burn companies also, where we analyze a little differently to give them capital, right? So tech or no tech is not a deterrent for us to funding a company, giving a debt to the business. Any business with good fundamentals and cash flows under control, good metrics, because old age traditional banking in terms of underwriting will not go out. We might replace a collateral with a cash flow underwriting, or what we call as, if I'm doing underwriting based on certain data, and if I'm monitoring that data also of that business post underwriting, that solves the purpose, that mitigates my risk. I don't need that collateral then. So it's combined with underwriting and monitoring. And that is where you have digital footprints of the businesses today in terms of GST, banking, their transaction data on marketplaces, e-com marketplaces, ERPs, payment service providers, that help you to understand the business a little better, their sticky revenue streams, and then underwrite them and then monitor them as well to reduce your risk.
That's what Mr. Suresh also said, that right now you have what you were mentioning, that there has been such a radical shift in the way banks assess the borrowers also, that earlier it was a relationship-based transaction, now on the digital footprints, fraction of seconds you can have. Also, I feel that from a startup perspective, if you have a credible bank, a pan-India national bank on your cap table, that really helps. It ultimately gives confidence to the investor who is coming on board, right? If you have a great relationship with the bank. I am sure there are a lot of questions in the delegate side. We can just take maybe two before we get the rapid fire. The gentleman with the green shirt here, and then, yeah. Yes, sir.
Before you ask a question, I wanted to add to what has been discussed so far. You know, the banks, all the banks have a strong desire to come and fund startups. I mean, we have very deep relationship with the banking sector, and I'm not supposed to disclose the names, but two very big private sector banks have entered into MOU with us, wherein when we lend to a company, a portfolio company, they will be co-lending with us, and these are the people who will be coming at a bank rate of interest, will be coming at much, much higher. The venture debt is, of course, higher than the bank rate. And they are coming along with us only because they want to be in this business, but they would want somebody to do the thorough due diligence before they can come in. Now, they are not looking for any kind of incremental collateral beyond what we are taking. And we are, as a new generation lenders, venture debt is a new generation lender, we are not looking for hard collaterals. We are looking for, you know, cash flow and some kind of a control over the equity of the promoters and things like that. Very, very basic stuff. And just look at it. Our intention is that we will remain in the company for 1.5 years, 2 years, 2.5 years at best. The bank once comes in, the hygiene the bank brings to the balance sheet and the credibility, which you were talking about, that is incredible. And they may start with a small, but they can become the lead banker going forward. And that's the intention. You know, all the banks have, you know, missed being the bankers of some of the unicorns that we talked about. And they want, this is their strategy, that they enter into a startup when they're young and build the relationship from there.
That's a win-win, right? Yeah. You have a question, the green shirt. Yeah.
Thank you everyone for the opportunity and for the wonderful session. I have two mini questions for Sandeep sir and Suresh sir. So my first question is on the same point that I think we discussed about the digital footprint part in the credit assessment. Is it the same thing that you mentioned about any traffic violations, or is it something related to the business instead? Maybe their online presence, or can you please explain that?
So today technology is in a so advanced. By inputting your driving license number, I can figure it out what are the cases against you. Basically, promoters. Okay. So now, if happen to be a private limited company, directors, we need not even give a deal. So with their DIN itself, we can figure it out what are the cases against whom, or what are the cases they have filed. Okay. Say for example, now I need to go to the different agency to figure it out in earlier days. Correct. Now, everybody must be getting if you are crossing the red signal, immediately we are getting SMS. Violation, we are getting the challan is coming on the Y SMS. So now the back end way, everything is getting tracked. So now I am inputting, I need not input your driving license. By inputting your mobile number, I can figure it out against this how many cases are. So this is what I want to do.
Understood, thank you. And my second question is to Sandeep sir, if this is just a general sentiment question. You mentioned about the LGDs being secured for the banks, which makes them comfortable in lending, even though the CGTMSE guarantee is available. But at the same time, does it also put us in a direction where the risk weighting of the assets are moving toward a higher percentage? My question essentially basically means that banks now lend, according to me, for a sustainable growth, even for working capital or term loan. But what if an entrepreneur or an MSME person wants to have some sort of an exponential growth? Would banks be in future be comfortable in doing that?
Yeah, I mean, as long as the projection that is being shown or which is being captured by the data, and if it is reasonable to believe that that projection is all right, I don't think there should be anything negative about having exponential growth. If a banker is convinced that what is being projected is achievable, then he'll be more than happy. I mean, I don't look at it as a you know, doubt, seeds of doubt in the mind of a banker. I don't think so. What do you say, sir?
Thank you very much.
Hello, sir. I'm Tarun from Earth Organic Inc. and we are a bootstrap agri-tech startup. So my query is regarding that CGMT also is there in AIF, the Agri Infra Fund. But while applying for the fund, we applied it through SBI. So we went out and there was a requirement that the primary property where the project will be listed will be taken as a mortgage, where we are working on a platform where we are assisting farmer and putting our project over their land and then building it around the community. So in that case, the mortgage of the initial land where we are putting the project is not possible. So is there any way out to support this in the AIF or not?
I mean, as far as the guarantee is concerned, this scheme is being looked after by NABARD and their guarantee institution, which is called NAB Sanrakshan. I guess there are some design issues in the guarantee scheme. So maybe because of that, you would be facing. But Mr. Suresh wanted to say something.
So land is owned by the applicant or?
Actually, sir, we are working on a platform where we are going in a public where the partnership with the farmer.
Yeah.
The farm land is owned by the farmer.
Okay.
And we will be putting a setup over there for nursery and then providing them saplings to the farmer and also the village, other farmers around. So in that case, the responsibility to overtake the irrigation and the machinery part lies on the farmer, and the technology part we are taking care of, SOPs we are taking care of, and the agri inputs we are taking care of.
Okay.
And in this case, farmer is leasing us the land for 5 years.
Okay.
And we are putting our unit over there.
See, you must be applied through the AIF portal.
I haven't applied through AIF portal. Okay. We just had a informal discussion with the local branch manager over there.
Land, how can we create a mortgage? There is no possibility of creation of mortgage. And the AIF scheme permits if there is a land is owned by the applicant.
Hmm.
And where the project is setting up in the same land, then it has to be taken as a security.
Okay.
You name it as a primary or collateral. Okay. No, if I'm setting it in a leased land or in a rented premises, that property I need not, can't be taken.
Okay.
So it is a well within the AIF norms. So you apply through the portal, PMU is there, private monitoring unit, they will approve. Once if it is approved by the PMU,
okay,
banker cannot reject.
Okay.
I think we can also take this offline. I think Mr. Suresh, I think he has a very interesting talk just after this panel on what they are doing for the MSEs in the startup space. I can just have like one more question if there it is, because we also have to get into the Suresh's talk. And then because we also have lunch in infestation of the speakers. Anybody else? Any question?
So this is a general question, and it is especially for you, sir. I understand you come from PE, private equity background. And one thing which I feel is not really very clear is, what exactly is the difference between PE and VC? So it will be really helpful, because there are so many companies, you know, who are actually there for more than 10 years. But right now they are going for an exponential stage, and practically startup funding is not what they are looking for. So I feel PE is the way, but it is pretty much overshadowed.
So the fact of the matter is, fundamentally, there is no difference between VC and PE. It is primarily the stage at which the investor is coming. And typically, the VC take the early stage risk, but you will find the VC is investing in the series D and E also. And the private equity guys typically come after series C, series D, and basically in the growth stage, when the company has gone through the initial, discovery process. But at the same time, you will find, for example, we as PE guys invested in Big Basket as a first investor, okay? And you will find the VCs, I mean, it's a fresh to home. We did Series E. That's where the Iron Pillar participated, which is a VC. So it is very, it's muddled up now. Initially, you could clearly say that there is a difference. But typically, fundamentally, a PE guy is not supposed to take a proof of concept kind of a risk. You know,
basically, PE people are smarter.
Sir, one counter question here. There are many companies who have not taken any sort of debt or equity instrument, you know, and they have come to a certain level. And they want to go for a big exponential growth. They have numbers to prove. And jaise banking terms se kehte hai na, thin file wale log hai basically. So are PEs open to such companies also?
I'll give an example. One investment we did 2 years back in a company called Symbiogenerics, which is a API company out of Bangalore. They were, I think, close to 200 crore with an EBITDA of something like 12%. And that's when we came in, the first round. So it's not necessary that in the initial stage you have to necessarily have an external funding. So long as you are growing on your own and you want to raise money on your terms at an appropriate time, that diamond doesn't say everybody is looking for growth-oriented, profit-making businesses run by excellent promoters and the entrepreneurs. So long as that is there, funding is a problem.
Thank you, sir.
I think just to sort of add to your point, I think it's a very valid question. And as somebody who has spent about 14 years in business journalism tracking private markets, I'll tell you where you're coming from. It's ultimately the question of risk and at what stage you're taking the risk. Venture capital, by the very nature, it's called venture capital. So it's the highest form of risk capital. When he said private equity are the smartest people, what he means that private equity guys will come into the stage of the company when there's a predictability in the revenue stream. Whereas the VC guys will come in early on when even there is non-predictability in the revenue stream, which is why they say that we are venture risk we are taking. Now the same venture guy will sell his or her stake to a growth capital guy at the Series D, Series E stage. Now, what has happened that the private equity guys have gotten greedy. They are saying ki sara paise to VC guys bana rahe hain. They are selling their stake to us. It's basically topi investing is happening. So I'll tell you what is topi investing. Uska topi uske sir. So at the angel stage, I raise money from you. I give you 10%. Then you sell that 10% to him at a higher valuation, which is a pre-series VC fund. He sells that stake to a Series A VC investor at a 10% higher markup. He sells it to again Series B investor, again a VC fund. Till the time you are Series B, maybe you are not making money, you are not making profits. But when you have a discussion with a Series C investor, the growth capital guy will question a Sequoia or an Axel or any early stage fund that you have taken the venture risk. Have you grown this company to a stage where I can come in? Because I want to see predictability in the revenue stream. If that is not there, I am not giving you a 30%, 40% markup. So what is happening in this TOPI investing scheme? That there's a last man standing phenomenon. And maybe in a lot of these venture cases, SoftBank is the last fool standing. Because that investor has bought the stake of so many VC firms, angels, sabko exit mil gaya 100 times, 200 times, 300 times. And SoftBank is now taking say 45%, 50% of the company. And the company is still not making money. That is a SoftBank early, that is a late stage growth VC risk. But a typical PE fund, if you were to go to say a multiples private equity or a Chris Capital, they will completely say no to a company not having predictability in revenue stream. So they have very strict guidelines on how to invest. So that really is the key difference. And of course, with because so many companies, and now with the Baiju's case happening, I think a lot of people are steering away from very exponential tech companies with very high risk. So like what everybody has said till now, we want companies fundamentally making money. You need to have a bit of positivity, simple, take it or not take it. So that really is the crux of it. And I think we also have a very interesting talk by Mr. Suresh from IDBI Bank on what really they are doing from an MSME banking solutioning perspective. And I would really urge all the entrepreneurs to listen to this, because don't be under this quest of just raising money from startup investors. Don't forget your good old debt. Don't forget your good old bank. That will always come to help you. And that is a note, I think it's a good time to wrap it up. Should we have the rapid fire or not? Sure. Now it's time to put you all on the rapid fire. Are you guys ready?
Not really, but we don't have any options.
Okay, I'll start with you, Mr. Verma. Most unusual or unorthodox pitch which got you baffled?
I mean, if you're talking about my present avatar, then I don't get any pitch. I mean, and whatever pitch is there, I am supposed to make a bowling on that, being a guarantor. So, I mean, I'll let it pass to maybe to Ajay to answer this one.
Yeah. But like the most unorthodox pitch, we were like baffled. What is he even saying?
Absolutely blank. Yeah, the only thing I can remember is that during the COVID times, a company approached and they were into, fish and meat business. And I said, boss, I can't really do a due diligence. I mean, I can't go deep. So let things settle and then we'll do it. He said, no problem. We will do Zoom due diligence. So effectively, I think that company is fresh to home. And effectively, the entire due diligence, the outside due diligence was done through Zoom.
Fantastic. But that came across being a good investment for you in the hindsight. Suresh sir, the question for you. If you were to give me one thing about Shark Tank, which you think is overhyped, what is that?
I have to pass this question.
Okay, I come to you now. And yeah, sure.
I think a lot of businesses go there at a very small revenue scale and give much more than that what is required. I think, and you go there for working capital, I think equity is very important. In your ownership is very important. You should value that.
Yes, you should definitely value equity and ownership. And one red flag that immediately gets you concerned about an MSME that you would say, I will not fund this, no matter what it is.
Diversion of funds. Because most of the MSMEs have related parties, diversion of funds is one red flag that is very important.
Thank you. Can we hear it up for this incredible panel? This shared so much insight on this.